Yeah. For example, now in the first limb, that the court has exercised jurisdiction not vested in it by law. The examples which can be done here, where the court assumes jurisdiction, which does not possess on account of pecuniary territorial limits by reason of subject matter of the suit. So when a suit is required to be filed in the Bombay High Court, for example, recovery of more than 2 crore, 1 crore, and you could not have filed a suit in the City Civil Court, Bombay. So that objection should be raised by the defendant at the very outset and take out the application. If the application is rejected, you can come in revision. Yes, this order is perverse, not maintainable. The court doesn't have jurisdiction. That is one example. Then entertaining an appeal from order which is not appealable. Suppose, for example, the district court has entertained rejection application for amendment under Order 6, Rule 17 has been rejected. The plaintiff or defendant took out an application for amendment of the pleadings or an application under Order 1, Rule 10 for joinder of a necessary proper party is rejected. Why the application is made, for example, say civil judge, junior division, senior division, in any suit pending before it. Now, the district court entertains an appeal under the provisions of Order 43 or Section 96. It is not an appealable order, because when you see that here, order rejecting amendment is not appealable because it doesn't come fall within the ambit of Order 43 or under Section 104. So when it is done wrongly by the court, it means the appellate court has wrongly assumed jurisdiction that it has got power to file an appeal. So the other party can invoke, go to the High Court under revision that the invocation of power by the district court in respect of an order which is not appealable is erroneous. The court did not have jurisdiction. So the order is totally suffering from the vice of illegality because the court did not have jurisdiction. So you can come in revision in the against this order again. Okay, please note that. Now the entertains a suit in which has no jurisdiction that I have given you illustration. Makes an order where it does not have jurisdiction to make. So the you learned under section 15 and 16 of the Code of Civil Procedure. The immobile property which is situated in a particular area, the suit should be filed within the local limits of jurisdiction of the court. If your property is situated in the city of Mumbai and you are residing in Delhi, you cannot file a suit for recovery just because you brothers are residing in Delhi. So the property is situated in Mumbai, because section 16 of the Code of Civil Procedure clearly mandates and tell you that all suit for in respect of a recovery of immovable property should be filed in a court where the property is situated. Now the property is situated in Mumbai and both of you are residing in Bangalore or Delhi, any place, you could not have filed a suit as per your convenience, wasn't it? So the entertaining of the suit itself is wrong. The other party can come before the court that the suit is in the wrong forum and it should be dismissed. So the revisional court will exercise the jurisdiction because there's a breach of the provisions of section 16. Isn't it? The section 16, you have learned it, clearly said that you must file a suit here in the court. Yes, it is a different issue where administration suit is filed in Bombay, where the property of your grandfather left in Calcutta, Madras and Delhi, everywhere. You file the suit after obtaining the leave under clause 12 of the latest patent or leave under section 20. That kind of a suit is maintainable. But if it is a suit between A and B, B and B who are residing outside the territorial jurisdiction of your court and the property is situated, for example, in Bombay and people are residing in Delhi, you cannot file a suit in Delhi for recovery of a property in Bombay. So you can invoke the provisions of section 115 for dismissal of that suit. Then it says that granting an injunction without considering relevant principles on this plane. Now, earlier, this round could have been good earlier, prior to amendment, not now. Now, one of the paramount factor for consideration in a prayer for grant of injunction, there must be prima facie case, there must be balance of convenience, irreparable loss, injury, prejudice should be caused to anyone. If the court, the trial court, did not consider any of the ingredient and injunction is granted, then you could have come in revision earlier, but now you cannot come. Please note that after the amendment of the provisions of section 115, mere grant of injunction is not disposing of the suit. You could not come before the court. Now here are some of the examples given by Justice Chakkar in his famous book, Code of Civil Procedure. Takwanis, if you see also, they have mentioned, according to me, you should not be writing those examples because they are all prior to amendment. So when you see the judgment I have given you of Justice, the Nariman judgment is covering the field now. It covers the amended part here. There are many other examples where an appellate order is passed by the appellate court directing rehearing of suit without recording or finding sufficient cause for non-appearance of the parties. Now earlier, where the court transferred the suit without issuing notice, affording hearing, so and so. Now this is again an interlocutory order. According to me, it cannot be challenged in the revisional court before the court. Now the second limb of section 115 says that here that the subordinate court have failed to exercise jurisdiction so vested. Now in the earlier case, it did not have jurisdiction and granted the relief. Now in the second case, the subordinate court have failed to exercise the jurisdiction and failed to discharge it. Now when you have jurisdiction, why have you not done it here? Now for example, the City Civil Court, Bombay, under the provision, can entertain a suit, can a suit under Section 6 of the Specific Relief Act and grant, can consider the prayer for injunction, isn't it? And it has a power to also conduct a trial. But the City Civil Court took the plea that year, the suit filed by the plaintiff against the defendant, he is his own landlord, he is his own tenant. In my opinion, this suit is not maintainable before me. He passes the order. He said that it is a suit between a landlord and tenant. It should go to the small cause court without taking into consideration the fact that it is a suit under Section 6 of the Specific Relief Act. So there is a conflicting judgment of some of the courts where a landlord throws his tenant out. Only the civil court can entertain a suit under Section 6. Now, Section 6, you know that, contemplate two types of suit. One is a suit within 6 months summary suit. Secondly, if the summary suit you do not want to invoke, you have a right to file a substantive suit under subsection 4 of Section 6. Mansi, please, can you open Section 6, subclass 4 of the Specific Relief Act? See that here, no appeal shall lie. That is it. Number four, nothing in this section shall bar the person from suing to establish his title to the property and to recover possession thereof. So, despite the fact that your suit under Section 6 is dismissed by the court, not to worry. Now, one of the cases in Chevex Kambata's case, Justice Chagla took up the plea that the suit was filed in the City Civil Court, Bombay, by the landlord. The landlord disposes the tenant. So the tenant had filed a suit in the City Civil Court for restoration under Section 6 of the Specific Relief Act, which was a summary suit. But had he filed a suit under Section 6 sub clause 4, that City Civil Court would not have jurisdiction. Suppose for a declaration that I am a tenant, I should not have been dispossessed without due process of law, that a suit would lie before the court of small causes court. But in the civil court, City Civil Court, if he merely said that I was in possession, whatever may be the capacity, I have been dispossessed without my consent and I should be restored back. That would become a civil suit under Section 9. So the city civil court refused to access or file the suit. Then an order passed dismissing the suit can be challenged in the High Court under Section 115 because the suit itself has been disposed of. But had the suit been kept pending alive, like in the case of Justice Nariman's case or in the case of a DLF case, then the revision would not be maintainable. Okay? That is some of the example. Now, another example which I may give you is that here. The earlier case, the refusal of the court to summon deponent of an affidavit for cross-examination. This was under Order 19, which was formally a ground for revision prior to amendment. Suppose for setting aside an application for ex parte decree under Order 9, Rule 13, the defendant says that I was sick and confined to a bed and I could not remain present. I am relying upon doctor's certificate to show in that regard. The plaintiff will say that the defendant has produced a false and bogus certificate. This doctor is not from the same area where the defendant was residing. He is residing somewhere 20 kilometers away from a different village. And in fact, the defendant was not sick. He was attending the marriage function of some other friend. And I want to cross-examine the doctor. Application is made under Order 19, Rule 2, CPC. If the application is rejected, pending the hearing and final disposal of an application under Order 9, Rule 13, CPC for setting aside, the plaintiff makes an application that I want to cross-examine the deponent. So under Order 19.2, please, Mansi, kindly open Order 19. Under Order 19.2, you have a right to cross-examine the deponent. Under Order 19, Rule 2, a power to cross-examine. If this application is rejected, though the trial court had power to allow the cross-examination, but did not allow, revision was filed earlier, the revisional court says, yes, the trial court, despite having jurisdiction to entertain the application, not done it, revision was maintainable. Now, I'm afraid after the amendment of the CPC, in the year 2002, this application would not lie under 115 because the suit itself, the main application is pending under Order 9.13. Now, what will be your remedy? Not revision. Your remedy will be 227 of the Constitution of India. Please note that as a youngest, don't mention in the examination, because it's not an appealable order. Know that. An application under Order 19, Rule 2 rejected, it is not an appealable order under Order 43. What are appealable orders? Only orders which are mentioned in Section 104 and Order 43, may A, B, C, D, say later till W. But you will find that this is nowhere there. Because if you go home and check it, I will not repeat it, it is not there, 110%. So, by virtue of the amendment to CPC, which clearly said that here, this order is not finally disposing of the proceeding. The proceeding for setting aside the ex parte decree are pending before the trial court. If it is rejected, you have a right of an appeal under the provisions of 96. So, revision will not lie against the order not allowing you to cross-examine. So the presently your remedy will be under Article 227 because under Article 227, the High Court has got much more substantially greater powers. Whereas the power of the High Court under 115 are very narrow, only limited to jurisdictional error, is only limited to final orders which are passed where appeal doesn't lie. So even if a final order is passed, the appeal is not maintainable, you can come before the court. The final order is pending. What is the final order in this application? Setting aside the ex parte decree under Order 9, Rule 13. Now under Order 9, Rule 13, If the order is refused, you have a right to file an appeal under the provisions of Order 43. So there is no need to come for revision. So please note that here. Then the next example is given by Justice Chakkar in his book is here. Rejection of a counterclaim on the ground that original suit is dismissed on default. Now here is a very interesting. Now under the provisions of Order 8, you learn that defendant, apart from filing a written statement, he has a right to file a counterclaim under Order 6, under Order 8, Rule 6A, counterclaim and set off. Now counterclaim and set off, you learned it, they are separate suit. Because they are clubbed together, and forming one part of the suit. That is, to avoid multiplicity of proceeding, you can file a counterclaim. Suppose A have filed a suit for injunction against you, B can go for a counterclaim that for possession. He can go for a declaration that A may have filed a suit for cancellation of the agreement under the specific relief act under section 34. So B will file a counterclaim that there should be a specific performance, I should be put back into possession. So there is a counterclaim in that regard. So if the main suit is dismissed, if the main suit of the plaintiff builder is dismissed for cancellation, your counterclaim survives. But if the trial court rightly or wrongly has wrongly rejected your counterclaim, saying that the main suit of the builder for cancellation of the agreement is dismissed, I have dismissed, so your counterclaim also I am dismissing, which is wrong. Because you mentioned that this, under the provisions of Order 8, Rule 6A, dismissal of the suit doesn't ipso facto mean dismissal of the warrant court. So here revision would lie. Please note that under Section 5, because the trial court had a jurisdiction to try the suit, the subordinate court, namely the City Civil Court, Bombay, or the district court where the suit was pending, or the Civil Justice Senior Division. These are these courts which entertain suit for specific performance or a suit for cancellation of the agreement. So when the suit for cancellation of the agreement is dismissed of the builder, you are a purchaser, your suit, which is in a counterclaim under the provisions of the specific relief act section 15 to 20 for specific performance of a contract, namely for a declaration that this honorable court be pleased to declare that the agreement is valid and subsisting, that this honorable court be pleased to direct the defendant to specifically perform the contract, and that this honorable court be pleased to put the plaintiff into possession and with a direction to convey the property. So it is in a counterclaim. So the trial court, city civil court, or a district judge comes to the erroneous finding that plaintiff did not remain present, I have dismissed his suit. So I am also in the wake of the dismissal of the suit, since the counterclaim is along with the suit, I am dismissing it. So he dismisses both, which is a wrong order. Now such a dismissal is not appealable. You can file a revision application under 115 because the order of dismissal is wrong. The court has not passed a decree. It is just a dismissal order. So you can come under 115. That is an example. It's an erroneous order on the part of. Then say that here. Erroneous interpretation of statutory provision as obligatory instead of directory. Now this, I'm afraid, not mendable. Now, where the court wrongly hold the suit is not maintainable. Now, suit is not maintainable. I have given you the judgment of the Supreme Court in Khanna's case. The Khanna versus Dillon's case, SS Khanna and Dillon, that is 63 Supreme Court, where Justice Sarkaria, Hidayatullah, and Justice Shah, J.C. Shah's judgment, where the trial court passing an order that at the interlocutory stage, the suit is not maintainable, but does not pass a decree. that order is revisable because you could not have gone in appeal because there is no decree here. So in such a scenario, there is a failure of justice. Now, it is illegal order, and the order, there is a material irregularity. Mean because the learned judge has not recorded the evidence of the parties. The learned judge has not given anybody an opportunity to cross-examine the witnesses. The learned judge has not even framed the issues without recording issues, framing issues, just by reading plain and written statement, and he cannot come to the opinion that the suit is not maintainable. That kind of observations are erroneous. They suffer from the vice of illegality and with material irregularity, as the procedure contemplated for suit under the Code of Civil Procedure, which is a very cumbersome procedure. You know that the moment a suit is filed, written statement come into play, summons are issued, then discovery, inspection, interrogatory, filing of the list of document, filing of the application under Order 16, list of witnesses, then filing examination chief under Order 18, cross-examination under 137 of the Evidence Act, then the court recording your finding with regard to admissibility, non-admissibility of document, which order is passed by the court under Order 13, and read with Section 135 of the Evidence Act, that procedure has been completely bypassed. You cannot bypass this kind of a procedure and dismiss the suit in one stroke that, in my opinion, the suit is bad. And at the same time, he has kept the suit pending, saying that, here, I will record evidence later on. No, that having given you finding that the suit is not maintainable, you cannot keep the suit for recording evidence. That is a wholly perverse order. That is how the judgment of the Supreme Court in Major S.S. Khanna versus Dhillon is a very important judgment. When the revisional court can entertain, please just read the judgment two times, three times. And when the revision cannot be entertained, you read the judgment of Justice Nariman's judgment, which I gave you right now, 2019-6 SEC, that it takes Singh versus Shashi Verma's case. These are beautiful judgments correctly explaining the provisions of Section 115. Now see that Khanna's case clearly said that here the final decree was not passed, the order was rightly passed. Even the judgment of the Supreme Court in the case of the earlier case, which I said to you, DLF housing case. That is a DLF housing case, DLF housing versus Swarup Singh's case, is a beautiful judgment rendered by Justice Dua and Binger, Vaidyalingam's bench, where the district court passing an order staying the reference. Then the High Court disposing of the application, stating that entire money be paid. And if you pay the entire money to the plaintiff, the suit of the other party will become infectious. Under the reference under the Land Requisition Act, the adjudication takes place by recording evidence. It is not done at the interlocutory stage. Bypassing the court has held that year, the reference as well as the suit for specific performance will be clubbed together by recording common evidence. If that is so, when the suit is pending, High Court invoking his power under 115 says that the entire money be paid over. If money is paid over, what remains here? The suit will become infructuous. The rightly the Supreme Court says that here, under the circumstances in DLF housing case, the provisions of Section 155 does not permit the court to pass any order. The order was erroneous. The revision was held not maintainable. This is important. Please note that here, the revisional jurisdiction was construed in a very narrow, in a narrow manner, even prior to the amendment of the CPC, amendment of Section 115, which took place in the year 1999 by the Amending Act of 99, which came into effect in the year 2002. Now, 2002 judgment ke liye, judgment of Justice Nariman and Justice Saran's bench under Section 6 of the Specific Relief Act, where the suit was pending, during the pendency of a suit, the interlocutory application for mandatory order to put back into possession was rejected by the trial court, rejected by the appellate court, and the High Court is giving in platter, yes, I agree with your case, you should be put back into possession. That is erroneous. When the suit is pending and not disposed of, and you cannot pass, you cannot entertain revision at all. That is what the present context here. So the earlier rulings, please do not read the old CPC for invoking section 115. You must have a copy of the judge CPC which has been edited, published after 2002. Please note that here. 2002 ke baad hi lijiye aap. 3, 4, 5, now 220. Now go for the latest edition and also the Bayer Act, you will find this. In the old Bayer Act, you will not find the expression that the suit would have been finally disposed of. This has been recently added. And secondly, it says that the High Court shall not vary or reverse the order decree where appeal lies to the High Court or any court, subordinate court. Then again, it says that subclause 3 has been added. Revision shall not operate as a stay of the suit or other proceeding before the court except such a suit. Other proceeding is stayed by the higher court. Now, the here mere stay, mere filing of the revision application does not tantamount to granting a stay. Now, in certain circumstances, now rightly in the case of Khanna versus Khanna's case in the year 1963, the Supreme Court rightly granted the stay because the trial court kept the matter pending. Having given the opinion, Khanna's case, just SS Khanna, please open, Mansi. SS Khanna's case. SS Khanna versus Dillon's case. In this case, this proviso will apply. A revision shall not operate as a stay of the suit or the proceeding. Now, once the revision has been entertained by the court, you cannot take the plea that the revisional court has the suit can be stayed here. Now, the revisional court must pass a specific order. In this Khanna's case, the trial court having committed a serious error of law, namely, given a finding that the suit is not maintainable and keep the suit pending. So when the revisional court is approached under 115, the revisional court will admit the revision. It may not be possible for the High Court to dispose of the revision application immediately on the date of the admission. Please note that. Unlike a suit, the revision application or appeals in the High Court are brought for admission first. The court will consider whether rule should be issued or not. Admitted. A rule nisi is issued in writ petition and revision application before the court. They issue a rule nisi as regard the maintainability. When the court considers that yes, the trial court has committed an error of law, and when it had no jurisdiction, it has entertained the suit or had passed an observation that the suit is not maintainable, kept the suit pending. So in Khanna's case, the High Court has entertained the revision application and High Court had power to stay the proceeding. Please note that. Stay the proceeding because the trial court having given a finding it is not maintainable suit, then why did you keep the suit for recording evidence? You cannot take a somersault. You cannot appropriate and reprobate. Having given a finding that the suit is not maintainable, it is absurd to place the suit for recording evidence. So taking the provisions of subclause 3, you can apply to the court for the injunction be granted, staying the operation and implementation that the suit should not proceed in the matter. Or if the High Court is taking in the matter forthwith, the court will pass the order and disposing of the entire suit and stating that here the order passed by the trial court is erroneous, perverse, and the matter is remanded back for fresh hearing. Because the court should record, allow the parties to lead evidence in that regard. Without recording, cannot be. So this is what you should know. Okay, this item number, the proviso to section 115 and subclause 2 and 3 have been added pursuant to the Amendment Act of 1999, section 2, with effect from 1st July 2002. So please, my request is that all of you purchase a fresh new Bayer Act and commentary which has been published in the year 2020. So don't go for the old commentary if you want to see. Even if you want to see the Justice, the famous book of Justice what you call it, Tucker's book, please go for the latest edition. So hope you all are very clear. So finally here, the revisional jurisdiction of the, now I will sum up giving you illustration, the difference between an appeal, appeal and revision. Now appeals under section 96 or 96 and under 104. So they are, the appellate court has got a wide jurisdiction. The appellate court can give a finding on question of fact as well as question of law. The appellate court has power to even record evidence which you have learned under order 41 rule 27. But whereas the revisional court has no power to entertain a revision application on the finding of fact nor on a question of law, but only on a question of law which is wrongly applied or there's a breach of a specific provision when there is an illegality or a material irregularity and provided the proceedings have been disposed of. Please kindly note that. In the city of Bombay, from the city civil court, the Bombay High Court can entertain revision application from a suit under section 6 when the suit is disposed of, provided the city civil court has not followed the correct procedure. From the judgment and order of the small causes court trial court, the appeal lies to the division bench of the small causes court under section 34 of the Rent Act. When the appeal is disposed of by the small causes court in a suit filed by landlord and tenant, no second appeal lies. Please note that there's a specific provision under the Rent Act, no further appeal lies. Then your remedy will be what? Your remedy is to come to the High Court under 115. Only that against the order of the division, the appellate bench of the small causes court, your remedy is under 115 or 227 of the Constitution of India. Now the Bombay High Court is now mostly entertaining revisions against the judgment and decree of the small causes court, where the suit has been decreed or dismissed, where a decree for mean profit is passed. They are not entertaining of late 227. Formerly, the procedure was to entertain a writ petition under Article 227, which is a wider remedy. But now they are entertaining writ petition under Article 227 against interlocutory order. Now, for example, during the pendency of a suit, you filed an application for amendment of the pleading rejected by the trial court. It is an order not affecting your substantive suit. It is not disposing your suit, so no revision lie. So you can come in writ petition under Article 227 when you point out to the revision, the High Court under Article 227 in its extraordinary jurisdiction, which is called that, my lord, I will suffer grave loss, injury and prejudice if amendment is not granted. These are facts collected after the filing of the suit. If not brought on record, I will face injustice. Other side will not suffer any justice because he will have a right to file written statement. He has a right to cross-examine me. So where is the question of hardship to him? So on that count, the writ court will allow it. A revisional court will not entertain the revision because your suit is not disposed of, for example. Another example, now during the pendency of a suit in city civil court. Yeah.
5 minutes are left.
5 minutes. Another example, a question. Another example, during the pendency of a suit in the city civil court, Bombay, maybe a partition suit, maybe a specific performance suit, maybe a suit for mortgages, or a suit in the small causes court. You made an application for appointment of a court commissioner to see the premises and prepare a sketch plan that the defendant has carried out structural repairs. Now such a repairs and whether they are structural repairs or tenantable repairs, you cannot decide. You need the help of an architect. Now the trial court rejects your application. That the application is not necessary. It amounts to collection of evidence and let the plaintiff prove on his own. He may examine his own architect if you want, but why you want the court officer to visit? So if this application is rejected, it is not an appealable order. Because this is an application rejected under section 75, read with order 26, rule 9, read with order 39, rule 7. You know these are all provision we dealt. Also under section 30 of the Code of Civil Procedure. These are the rejection order. They are called procedural orders. Procedural orders not substantially affecting your legal rights and the suit is pending. When the suit is not disposed of, you cannot come in revision. So your remedy is to go to the High Court under Article 227 and not before the Revisional Court, because the Revision Court will say that your suit is pending. The order passed is not an interlocutory order affecting your legal right. This is only a procedural order. Procedural orders, revision will not lie. Please note that here. Only file writ petition under this order. Now, another difference between appeal and revision is that here, in the revision, you can only correct the jurisdictional error, as I mentioned to you right now. Whereas the appellate court can probe into your fact that the evidence has not been correctly recorded, issues are not correctly framed, and I will remand the matter back. And the judgment of the Supreme Court, High Court is not correctly rendered in the matter. They can go into it. The interpretation of the trial court is wrong. So there are wide powers under the provisions of Section 96 under Order 43 and Section 104 of the CPC to the Appellate Court. But whereas the Appellate Court exercising power under 100, namely High Court, can only decide a substantial question of law. Similarly, Supreme Court under Section 109, read with Order 45 and the provisions of the Constitution of India, that is Article 132 and 133, that also decide substantial question. But the Supreme Court has wide powers under the provisions of Section Article 142, plenary powers to pass any order and decree. So don't equate the order of the Revisional Court with the Appellate Court and the Supreme Court. The order of the revisional jurisdiction of the High Court is very limited, very narrow, and it is not possible to challenge unless the order has substantially disposed of your suit. It has disposed of, otherwise not. Now, please, hope you understood this lecture. Please ask me any question you have got or left out. Any quick questions before the time gets over? Nobody has any questions? Mansi, how much time is left out, please?
2 minutes.
2 minutes. Please take advantage of the 2 minutes because almost you know the law under the provisions of Section 115 and period of limitation which you have to file and in what matters you can invoke revision, what matters. So kindly bear in mind that the important judgments of the Supreme Court, which I gave you in Khanna's case, and as well as judgment of Justice Nariman in Tek Singh versus Shashi Verma's case. If you follow the judgment correctly, then you will have no problem. Revisional remedy is not an easy remedy. It's a very toughest remedy. The court of the High Court will not show indulgence as a matter of course in the matter. Now, next tomorrow, we'll take other provisions, certain provision. Of course, lastly, I'm going to take your execution proceeding. Before the execution, certain provision I would like to take the provisions of the CPC were not applicable to the Supreme Court and High Court under to the provisions of Article 226 and the provisions of Article 136. Why they are not? Like earlier, we read that here. Under Section 4, 5, 6, 7, the revenue courts, the act is not applicable. The CPC is not applicable unless the government or the state government or central government issues a notification applying the act. There is a bar, specific bar to certain court, price courts. Have you heard of the price courts? Anybody? Can you give me?